Take your Bibles and turn with me to Daniel chapter 7. And as you're turning, I'd ask you to also reflect on the very last words that Lisa sang, "I am lost without you." You know, that is a very, very good introduction to what God's Word has to say for us today. Daniel chapter 7, by some Jewish scholars, has been called the most important chapter in the Bible. Even Christian scholars have noted that Daniel chapter 7 is, if not the most important, one of the most important chapters in the Bible. And it's this way for this reason. Is that Daniel chapter 7 shows us the entirety of human history to the very end. And as Daniel is seeing the entirety of human history, he is scared. But what I love is that in the middle of this, God gives reason for hope. Read with me as I read Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. It says, "I continued watching in the night visions, and suddenly one like a son of man was coming with the clouds. He approached the Ancient of Days and was escorted before him. He was given dominion and glory and a kingdom so that those of every people, nation, and language should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will not be destroyed." Father, thank you so much for this that you have given Daniel. Thank you for preserving it for us. Lord, thank you for the hope that it gives us today. Lord, that no matter what Satan throws at us, that you are still in control and you have all things in your hand and that you will establish your kingdom through Jesus. Father, teach us today. Amen. You know, Daniel chapter 7, you can give it the name, "A New Day Is Coming." Because that is what happens to Daniel. As we move into this prophecy portion, I want us to remember this, is that when everything seems dark and grim, God will always have a plan that will end in ultimate victory. And he took time here to expound that to Daniel. And as Daniel was looking at this, he was scared. And why was he scared? Because it's important to note that when these visions took place, it says in the first year of King Belshazzar, well, that is the year 553 BC. And Belshazzar became king because his dad entrusted it to him. His dad was away on other things, and he says, "While I'm gone, you're the king." And his dad stayed gone the majority of the time. Daniel was about 65 to 70 years old when this happened. And he and the Jews were possibly concerned about their future because Belshazzar was very wicked. And God probably gave these visions to assure the Jews that they were secure. And how were they secure? Because God was telling Daniel that your people are going to play a part in the very end times. God was showing him that even here in captivity, your people will work to be the freedom of everybody later. You see, I believe that God was using these visions to remind Daniel that he is in control, and because of that, there will always be hope. Hope. We must have hope for the future. We must have hope to survive. And God was giving Daniel reason to hope. Look at the first thing he does here in verse 1. God reveals this during a time of judgment. You see, Israel was still being punished in Babylon because of what they did not do to follow God. They were still being punished their 70 years. Their time was not up. But even during this exile, God was still talking to his people. God was still encouraging them. He was doing this through Jeremiah. He was doing this through Ezekiel, through Daniel, through Nehemiah, and possibly Esther, depending on how she fits into that. You see, even though his people had abandoned him and lived in sin for that 490 years, he never abandoned his people. He kept coming back, and even in the times that they were there in captivity, he was still there encouraging them. Christians, there are times today when we are going to feel abandoned. And when we do that, we need to look back upon what happened here with Daniel and remember that God never abandons us and that there is a new day coming. When's it coming? I don't have his calendar. Sometimes I wish I did. Sometimes I wish I had his watch. I don't have his watch. I don't have his calendar. Because if I did, my confidence would be on the date, not on the date maker. God wants us to trust him. And that's where our hope lies, is in him. And now for the majority of this chapter, God is telling Daniel that he knows what's happening. Now we're going to put on some running shoes and dash through verses 2 through 25. The first thing that pops up here is the Great Sea. And what does that Great Sea mean? Well, that Great Sea could mean the Mediterranean. But God in his word defines what the sea is. That it is the earth. He does that in verse 17. So God is saying that from the earth, things are going to happen. But he knows what's going to happen. He knows when they're going to happen, and he will allow it to happen. Now, some people are asked, what about the winds? I did a lot of reading about that, and you know what the majority of the scholars say? I don't know. They don't know what it means. What they kind of come to a consensus on is it's probably all these forces that play upon nations and how these forces stir up strife and trouble. Don't get caught up on the winds. That's not important. Don't get caught up on the meaning of the sea. That's not important. What's important is God knows and God is in control. Well, what happens? Then we are introduced to all these beasts that come up. Now, we're going to quickly run through these. The first beast that comes up is a lion with eagle's wings. This is Babylon. God had told us that Babylon would be the first kingdom that come up, Nebuchadnezzar's dream in chapter 2. Well, how do we know this is Babylon? Because ancient text and images show us that Nebuchadnezzar was symbolized as a lion, both in the Bible and in ancient text. He's symbolized as a lion in Jeremiah 4:7, 49:19, and 22, Jeremiah 50, and as an eagle in Jeremiah 49, and in Lamentations, and in Ezekiel, and in Habakkuk. God said he was. The vision said he was. This is Babylon. That's why we use the Bible to interpret the Bible. If some man comes to you and tells you that that's not what the Bible says, you need to do two things. First, you need to do is to run from that. And second, you need to do is to dig in and find out what it means. The second thing that comes up is the bear. a bear with three ribs in his mouth. Well, we know who the bear is. That bear is the next kingdom, the Medo-Persians. And how do we know that? Because they were the next ones that came up. They were the ones that followed Babylon. Now, some people are asking, what are the ribs in its mouth? What a lot of people say is that those ribs represent the three great kingdoms that Medo-Persia conquered. And what God is saying is, here comes a beast. It's going to be a little bit worse than before. But I know what's coming. See, Daniel lived that transition. And then comes the leopard with four wings. Well, what does history tell us? That after Medo-Persia, Greece dominated the world. And you know, the leopard and Greece, they bear a lot of similarities. And why is that? The leopard is fast, and it has an insatiable thirst for blood. And the four wings upon the leopard's back increased the beast's speed. But it could also be representative of the four generals that Alexander had to help him conquer the world. You see, they conquered the world in about 10 years. Something that, you know, we don't even see done today. And their empire went from the borders of India all the way to the Mediterranean Sea. And then when Alexander died, that kingdom was split into four kingdoms. And then after that, a frightening and terrible beast. There's some people have said that this is not something that Daniel had ever seen before. I think that Daniel had seen something like this beast, but this beast was so grown and so powerful that it scared him. You see, this beast represents Rome, because Rome succeeded Greece. And just as it is symbolized by the iron legs and feet in chapter 2, so is this beast strong. And Rome, we know, was cruel. Just as this monster was different from all others, so the Roman Empire differed from those that preceded it. Rome possessed a power and longevity unlike anything the world had ever known. Nations were crushed under the iron boot of the Roman legions. Its power was virtually irresistible, and the extent of its influence surpassed the other three kingdoms. We read about Rome and its conquest today. You know, I can take you down to the railroad tracks, and I can show you that the influence of Rome is still here. You know, the railroad tracks are based upon the wheel size of a Roman chariot. And you know how the Roman chariots determined how wide to make those wheels? They had two horses. Those chariots cut the ruts for the roads that our tires and our trains still use today. And yet, as Daniel was seeing all of this, he was scared. And yet there's God in the background. He's going to show him something in a little while to remind him that while all of this turmoil is going on, I am still in control. Nothing is happening that I'm not allowing it to happen. You may question why, and that's okay. But I know, and I am going to preserve you. And then the text tells us about this little horn. This little horn that grew out It started out small, but it grew and it uprooted three other horns. You know, I want you to notice there were 10 horns there. Well, let's flip back to chapter 2. How many toes were on the statue? 10. I think those horns correspond to those 10 toes. And I think those 10 toes and those 10 horns correspond to something that is coming up. There is a lot of speculation about when the end is. I don't know when it's coming, but I can tell you this, we're one day closer. There are some things that God says must happen that I haven't seen him start formulating yet, but I see the ground is fertile for it. Christian, we need to look out and be aware for those things, but we must not let our search for those things override our search for God. God is still in control. Sometime in the future, there's going to be some type of kingdom or kings or conglomeration that's going to have 10 with it. And there's going to be somebody that is going to grow and become powerful and is going to uproot that. And that somebody is going to lead into a false sense of peace. That somebody is going to lead to have the temple rebuilt in Jerusalem. That somebody is going to blaspheme our Lord and Savior with every breath they take. These things are coming. I'm not going to stand here and say that they are here now, I can't. But I can say that I see, with the midst of everything that's going on, the roots of those. I don't know when it's going to take place. And I'll be honest, that's not what I am here to proclaim. I'm here to proclaim Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is the way to make sure that you do not have to experience some of this. Jesus Christ came to seek and save that which is lost. Jesus Christ came to save us and give us hope for a future. And that future is wrapped up in Him. We need to focus on Him, not the little horn. We don't need to dismiss the little horn, but our focus needs to be on the cross, not on the chaos that's coming. And then I love what he does. After he finishes giving all these animals and a glimpse into the future, he gives the scene in heaven. And what is the first thing that happens? I love what happens here in verse 9. As I kept watching, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was like snow, and the hair of his head like whitest wool. His throne was flaming fire. Its wheels were burning fire. You know, if you mark in your Bibles, that would be a good verse to mark. Revelation chapter 1. Because what does that sound like? What did John see right there on that prison island? He saw Jesus Christ. He was white as snow, like whitest wool, with flaming eyes. I want you to know that right here in this verse, this is not talking about Jesus Christ. But Jesus and God are the same. And what is God telling him? God is telling Daniel right here that I am pure and I will judge. The whiteness denotes the purity that God has. The fire denotes the judgment of God that is coming. God will judge the living and God will judge the dead according to the works that he has recorded. You know, we've got to be aware that there are books in heaven. There are libraries in heaven. Your name is recorded in heaven. Each and every person that has lived, their name is recorded in heaven. Where it's recorded depends where you will spend eternity. He's got a section of his library, the Book of Life, where all of those that have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, God writes your name, possibly in his son's blood, in that book. And everyone whose name is written in the book of life, our sins have already been judged at the cross. And we will hear the words, "Welcome home, my good and faithful servant." But there's another section of that library. That's the book of works. And that book of works is for those that have never accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Their name is written in there. And if your name is written in that book, in that section of the library, don't get mad at me. This is not me. This is God saying this. You will not experience eternal bliss in heaven. You will experience eternal separation in hell. That's not my words. That's God's words. Judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. Not just on people, but on kingdoms and on rulers. One of the things that I saw in this that just I've never thought about was that all the previous empires, you know, they had lived on in a sense that they were absorbed into the next empire. But that fourth empire will be completely destroyed and replaced by a totally new world order, the kingdom of God. You see, what happened in chapter 2? In chapter 2, that stone from heaven came and it destroyed the entire statue, so it was nothing but dust. From the head to the toe, and it blew away. Until God judged that kingdom and those four kingdoms, they all stood in some way. But there's coming a day when all vestiges will be blown away by the judgment of God. And this judgment comes because Jesus will enter the world again. I want you to notice that each time Jesus comes to this earth, judgment occurs. What happened when he came 2,000 years ago? He judged your sin and your shame, and he took it to the cross, and he nailed it to the cross for you, so that you could be relieved of that. You could be forgiven of that. So that you could have a new day. And the second time he comes, what is going to happen? He is going to judge the world and sin. And he is going to execute that judgment and blow those kings, those kingdoms, all away so that nothing is left but him. As I think about that, I think about what he said in Mark 14. But he kept silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest questioned him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power, coming with the clouds of heaven." And when he comes that second time, it is to topple all that Satan has built up and replace it with what should have been. So we get down to the end of the chapter, and we see that God is triumphant. You see, what does verse 26 tell us? Verse 26 tells us simply that judgment is coming. But the court will convene, and his dominion will be taken away and be completely destroyed forever. God is going to open up the books on the kings. God's going to open up the books on the kingdoms. God's going to open up the books on the people. And if your name is not written in the book of life, you will be condemned eternally before the eternal God. You see, this is good news for the saved, but for the unsaved, it's very horrible news. Eternal separation from God. Eternal separation. One commentator put it this way: "Now the kingdom of God fills the earth. War is no more. Universal peace and prosperity pervade the globe. It should be noted that the destruction of the Antichrist takes place before Christ's kingdom is established, demonstrating that the kingdom of God in view here did not begin at Christ's first coming, but will be inaugurated at his return." Christ is coming to reclaim what's his, both his bride and his possession. And we will all be remade. So what? What does all of this mean for us today? There's only two things I want you to take away from today's lesson. The first is that nothing will take God by surprise. You see, he already knows what has happened and what will happen and how it will happen. All that he allows to happen is for his goal of establishing his physical kingdom on earth. While we are surprised and sometimes shocked by what is going on, we must always trust God for the ultimate outcome. You know, as I was thinking about this and writing this out, I was reminded of Anna. You see, Anna loves Harry Potter, and she loves the Harry Potter films. And in the first film, there is a piece toward the end where there is a game of wizard's chess being played. If you know how to play chess, wizard's chess is just chess, but on a bigger scale. And as they were playing it, one of the characters, his name was Ron, it suddenly hit him. Ron didn't need to move on, but Harry did. It was more important for Harry to get to the end than Ron, because Harry could fix what needed to be fixed. And so what did Ron do? Toward the end of the game, he told Harry, "I am going to do this." And Harry realized, "Ron, if you do that, you will sacrifice yourself." But Harry, this is the only way to win. Ron did that, and Harry defeated the evil that was in there. My friends, Jesus did the same thing. The only way for us to win is to accept his sacrifice. And God knew that that had to happen. It didn't take him by surprise. He didn't negotiate with Satan. He said, "This is it. This is the way to victory. And he gave himself for you and for me so we can live eternally. The second thing I want you to take away from today is that for a Christian, there is always hope. See, we can look around this world and see the horrors that are out there. We see war, we see crime, we see injustice, cruelty, we see messed up thinking and everything that goes with that. And while they should scare us now, we must remember that which is coming. And I to go over to Revelation 21, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride, adorned for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne, "Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be there with them, and they will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away." Then the one seated on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." He also said, "Write, because these words are faithful and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will freely give to the thirsty from the spring of the water of life. The one who conquers will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the cowards, faithless, detestable, murderers, sexual immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their share will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." We have hope of a new beginning because God said so. We have hope because Jesus gave himself for our sins. We have hope because he went to the grave to pay for our sins. We have hope because he rose from the grave. We have hope because he broke our bonds of death. We have hope because he went up. And we have hope because he is coming back. Don't let anyone ever tell you that you don't have hope. We're going to face dark times. And in those dark times, I want you to remember a stanza that Edward Mote wrote years ago. And it still applies to us today. And I invite you, when we get to the chorus, if you want to sing it, sing it. Edward Mote wrote this years ago. "His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul give way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand." We have hope because of the rock. We have hope because of the grave. We have hope because the clouds will part and he will come back. And Christian, as we close today, never lose sight of your hope. Never lose sight of your hope. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Now, Father, I thank you for reminding us that a new day is coming. And Father, while we look around this world today, Lord, we shake our heads at some of the things that we see. Lord, we shake our heads at how people have legislated sin. Lord, we shake our heads at the wars that are going on. Lord, we shake our heads at the suffering that is occurring. Lord, we shake our heads because of all the pain and sin that we see. But Father, we know that you have given us hope. Lord, we know that your grave is empty, and that empty grave gives us hope for tomorrow. And Lord, we know because your word says you are coming back. Father, help us to focus on the hope for tomorrow, and Lord, give us opportunity to tell others about the hope that they can have today. In your name we pray, amen.